I'd like to talk to you today about what is identified as the cost of discipleship, or better yet, the process of what it means to follow Christ. Even the words following Christ needs to be defined. What does it mean to be followers of the way, as the early Christians were called? A way of life, a new way of being a human being, a new way of seeing life. Christians down through the centuries have understood that to enter a spiritual way of life, one that imitates the model given to us, the prototype, if you will, given to us by Jesus of Nazareth, is a costly thing. It's costly only because it goes against the grain of our nature. It isn't about giving money. It isn't about many other things that we take literally, which we'll be discussing here in the scripture today. Religion has so often confused people down through the centuries by misreading the teachings of Christ. You have to take it all within the great context of the kind of God Christ revealed and the kind of life he called us to. You know, people have gone off in the desert, people have fasted and so forth, but all of those different methods, if you will, of seeking to live the spiritual life were external efforts for an internal reality. What Jesus and all great teachers connected to spirit, revealed to humanity, is a change of mind, a change of heart, a new attitude, a liberation from all of the things that turn us into intolerant, hate-filled people. The aim is to radiate goodness and love in a world that has so precious little of it. It isn't something unreachable. It isn't just for a special kind of people with special gifts and sensitivities. All of us, whoever you are out there, have the capacity to find our way onto the true way of living, which gives us a promise of a good life, a meaning-filled life, and then we're told a greater life in the spirit world. But let's focus on just this life, in this reality, our daily life. Jesus gives us specific instructions on how we can go about evolving, if you will, into a new consciousness of living. And so when we turn to the teachings of the Christ, we find embedded within the scriptures specific steps that we must take psychologically to put us back on the right path. So, in this scripture here today, we hear large crowds were traveling with him. And he turned and said to them, so, Jesus has shown amazing things to them, and they all want to be part of, close to him and around him and see more wonders from him. But now he turns to them and makes them face what he's really here to tell them. He says, whoever comes after me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Now, if you've heard this before, and surely most of you have, that's a very disturbing thing. The one who comes into the world to help us live life correctly, to help us love with the unconditional love of God, is now telling us that in order to come after him, to follow his way of life, we have to hate. We have to hate life and our family, surely that can't be right. Well, if your heart of hearts tells you that can't be right, you're right. It's a matter of how we understand what he is saying. That word hate is a translation, is an attempt to capture something much grander that he meant to say. Let me give you an example. The prophet Malachi, the last prophet of the Old Testament before the appearance of Jesus in the world, says the following about the Messiah. He will restore the hearts of the parents to their children and the hearts of the children to their parents. And then we hear Jesus say, you must hate your parents and your children. So there is a disconnect there. Don't be afraid of those. Spirituality is full of paradoxes and requires that we think in a deeper way. We are always called to search, to seek, to knock, to make an effort to better understand what is being said. Don't ever read these sacred teachings just on the surface. There's nothing surface about them. They're from the depths. Jesus has told his disciples, put your nets into the deep. Go deep with this. So, if it doesn't mean hate, which it cannot, not from he who brings love into the world, the one who says, love your enemy, surely cannot mean hate your parents. So what must it mean? That word hate in the original language, in the Semitic language, in Aramaic, means to detach oneself from. For instance, it's used in the Old Testament about Jacob and Rachel and Leah. You'll find that it said that Jacob loved Rachel more than Leah. And then it says he hated Leah, same translation, but then he goes on to have seven children with her. So clearly the word hate is a mistranslation of the meaning in Semitic, in the original language. What we find here is the idea of detachment, which is one of the great Christian, spiritual, and Buddhist and other traditions, ways of connecting with spirit. To detach yourself from does not mean to no longer love. It means to be free from. And I want you to think for a moment about your own families, your parents, your children, your wife, your husband, and how we are shaped by them. Some of us spend a lifetime trying to please our parents. Some of us create an identity that is a rebellion against our parents. Either way, we are shaped, even in adulthood, by those relationships. When God comes along, the vaster reality of life, we are called to not be limited or victimized by those kinds of relationships. To detach oneself means to find another way of loving comes through a spiritual understanding of life. You know, Abraham was told in the beginning, in Genesis, to leave his parents' home and go into a land that I will show you, to step out into the unknown. Each of us must be willing to leave the familiar in order to rediscover our true identity. In order to truly love our families, we must be able to see them from a greater perspective. You know how we help our children find themselves rather than try to make them into what we want them to be. We have to be willing to recognize their independence, their separateness, while still being so much a part of us. We have to be able and willing to forgive our parents and understand why they did what they did and love them for what good they did for us and what we owe them in our lives. All of this is a more objective view, which allows us to truly love them. You know, there's the saying, blood is thicker than water, which means you put your loyalty with family first, regardless of anything. Some of you know the story of the Hatfield and the McCoys in the old days, who warred for years, these two different families, killing each other off, fighting for their families. There is something almost tribal about that. Jesus invites us into the larger human family, calls us to expand our love and care and relationships and not limit ourselves to the one group, us against them, mentality, which ends up fostering hate and intolerance. He goes on. He tells us in the same process that we're called to enter into, whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Just like whoever does not deny themselves. Now, this has been interpreted in ancient time as, you know, self-flagellation. Some monks would beat themselves, you know, hate themselves. That is not at all what the Prince of Peace, what the lover of humanity means. We are called to reject the part of us that is centered only on self-interest, only on self-preservation, only on number one, so that we become able to enter a larger awareness and consciousness that can give of itself. And in giving of ourselves to others, we find ourselves, we find our greater selves. You know, that's a law that happens to every mother that truly cares for her children, to a man and wife who truly love each other, transcending their own limited interests for the sake of the other. In other words, dying to themselves for the sake of the other. They find a deeper love, a deeper capacity to be who they truly are. This is part of the strange mystery of spirituality, to die in order to live. So don't take the words literally. They are meant to describe a process of growth that leads us into a maturity of being that is capable of self-sacrificial love to the glory of God. Erasing that which keeps us confined to caring only for a few and not liking anybody else. There's no spirituality there. There's no real love there. It's when our love expands that we can truly love even our own in a new way. We find that bearing the cross doesn't mean living a life of hardship. Jesus comes into this world to give us joy, to show us a path of light, not of heaviness and misery. To bear the cross is to commit oneself to a higher purpose than simple self-preservation. He goes on to say, for which of you intending to build a tower does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? In other words, instead of just jumping into something, you have to intentionally consider what it takes to get from A to Z. What this means in the spiritual world is you have to realize we have to make steps from one stage to another. A lot of people seem satisfied just going to church, and they think that's a religion. They don't realize that there's a constant, never-ending process of growth. And Jesus says to this large crowd that has enthusiastically joined him, count the cost of what it takes to really follow me. Don't just jump in with enthusiasm without realizing what you must do internally to become a true disciple, one who learns the way of Christ in this world. He goes on to say, Otherwise, if you don't look at the whole plan, when he's laid the foundation for his tower and is not able to finish it, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. You know, many people who seek to do good so often burn out, just like the man building the tower. They don't see the whole picture and they are crushed eventually by their loss of will to continue, by fatigue, by discouragement. But if you build a foundation that allows you to let Spirit work through you, then you're able to work past the obstacles, the disappointments, the fatigue, and continue on and finish the job. Engineers understand this. People in regular secular jobs understand this. Spiritually, it is similar. We have to recognize what we are getting into and what we have to leave behind and what we have to let go of. And that is costly because nobody wants to make efforts that go against the grain. Like the salmon going upriver. That's what we have to do with our habits and our comforts so that we can become new beings, reach new levels we didn't know we had within us. Jesus goes on to say, what king going out to wage war against another king will not sit down first and consider whether he's able with 10,000 men to oppose one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then he will, while the other is still far off, send a delegation and ask for terms of peace. This puts it in the context of how serious this is. Life and death. What is at stake? Religion is not simply a Sunday morning event. It is an everyday decision making. Every moment, every relationship. We have to recognize what we need to put into it. What we need to work on. We are the ones who are most in the way of our relationship with God. And therefore, we have to face ourselves honestly and see where it is in us that vanity, that taking offense blocks our capacity to go to the next level. So you see how there is a whole process. One of the things we need to, quote, hate or be detached from is ourselves. All of us respond to what we consider offense and are put into these negative states by other people and how they behave, and therefore we are never free to make the right choices. We are just reacting to how others treat us. How dare you say that to me? As long as we live there, we cannot enter the spiritual path, because the spiritual path begins with humility. And humility is a form of death to the self that wants all the attention or that is at the center of the universe. Humility is recognition of our dependence on God, of our weakness. Not needing to be patted on the back, not needing to get everything done the way we want it done. Think of all the requirements we have of others. If you die to that, if you free yourself from that, life changes dramatically. And you enter the path of peace, the path of acceptance, the true capacity to care for others. It's the same with judgment. When Jesus says, do not judge, it means unplugging ourselves from our attitudes that we have, all of us have, towards other people. And Jesus repeatedly tells us, you know, look at yourself first. Don't be looking at another. And how dare we judge another that God loves and forgives? You see, we set ourselves up for being unable to let Spirit mold us and renew us through those countless attitudes that we're comfortable with. Again, it's going against the grain. Learning to disconnect from what we're familiar with, from what we've gotten used to, so that we can begin to live in a new way. As you can see by now, the crowds that have followed him are in shock, because what he's saying is always to shock us out of our state of sleep, of our unawareness of what we are called to be in this world. And so then Jesus says, therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. And sure enough, down through the ages, people have taken this literally and given up all their possessions. Do you think Jesus wants you to be a vagrant in the street? Wants you to have a giant yard sale of everything you own and lose your responsibilities? Of course not. This is a metaphor for internal freedom from our possessions. The way we give up our possessions is not to sell the furniture, but to free ourselves from being obsessed with them, so that we are available to God, so that we can use them right. You see how that puts a whole new perspective on what Jesus calls us to do. Sometimes it's easier to sell your possession than to work on yourself. To sell your possession also means to get rid of that which is so important to us, like our pride, like our need to be right. Sell that, the need to be right. Think how much damage that has done to your life. It's easier to go do some big event and feel good about yourself and think you've become righteous in doing that than to face the ordinary thing of being able to forgive somebody who has offended you, to sell your possession of yourself that is so precious to you that everybody becomes an enemy who dares to say bad things about you. So Jesus is talking about internal liberation from everything so that we can enter the peace of God, enter the consciousness of our spiritual reality, and begin to live in a new place, unfamiliar to us, a place that allows us to then become God's blessing in this world. This is a process, a very personal process, very intimate process, one that we must follow through day by day, bearing our cross daily, until we have entered a place of freedom from all things, which allows us then to truly love all things. May this be your journey. May this be your joy. May you discover this new world and become a new creation to the glory of your Maker. God bless you this day.